Throughout the years and decades, Juventus Football Club was always a favorite for all the competitions. But in the end of the 80s and entering the 1990s, the Bianconeri went through one of their roughest years since the club was founded. This is the story of Juve's fall from grace and how they fought back to stand on Italy's and Europe's podiums.
Per una ragione veramente tremenda, è morto Gaetano Scirea.
Juventus are European champions!
When Italian manager Giovanni Trapattoni took over coaching duties at Juventus on July of 1976, the Bianconeri went on to achieve all the available titles within the 10 years the Italian manager had spent in Turin. The Italian league title 6 times, the Coppa Italia twice, and also became the first European club to win all the different European competitions under UEFA's umbrella. And those were the UEFA Cup, the European Cup Winners' Cup, the prestigious European Cup, the European Super Cup, and also they won the Intercontinental Cup as well. And the team was full of special players in each position, like the French star Michel Platini and the Polish Boniek, and the Capitano Gaetano Scirea and the legendary keeper Dino Zoff. The team was led upstairs by ex-legend and current president at that time, Giampiero Boniberti, who took over in the beginning of the 70s after the Agnelli's blessings, the family that owns the Bianconeri. But with the arrival of Milan's new president Silvio Berlusconi to the footballing world, and after Napoli had finally built a side worthy of the title for Maradona, the local competition was getting very tough for the Bianconeri. The competition got fiercer after Trapattoni left at the end of the 86 season to coach Inter Milan, who were in the middle of a new project. It was at that moment that Juventus entered a long spell of barren years, and especially in terms of the Scudetto. In the 86-87 season, in came manager Rino Marchesi to replace Trapattoni. And with almost the same squad, the title holders failed to reclaim the title. After losing home and away in the crucial matches against Napoli in the league, as the Partenopei lifted their first Scudetto in history, thanks to Maradona's exceptional performances throughout the season. The Bianconeri also failed to win a single title that season for the first time in 7 years. And following a match against Sampdoria in May, Platini lost the speed and power in his legs, as he said in a recent interview, as he decided to retire at the end of the season at only 32 years of age. The club quickly tried to compensate the Frenchman in the following season with the Welsh goalscorer Ian Rush, who had an excellent year before arriving in Torino, which saw him net 40 goals in the 86 season with Merseyside club Liverpool. But the Welshman had a hard time in Italy after suffering an injury in the first couple of months, and also as he struggled with the Italian language, which affected his interactions with his teammates and the media as well. Platini mentioned that the Welshman didn't arrive at the best of times, as the club was going through a transitional period after his departure along with Boniek and Tardelli, and also after Scirea and Cabrini were getting older. But the responsibilities must be shared between the players, as the Bianconeri had lost a big chunk of creativity in the middle after Platini's departure. And despite a young Michael Laudrup featuring in the squad, the team had lost its spark. So after Rush had scored only 7 goals in the league, the Bianconeri ended the season in 6th position, which is considered their worst showing in 30 seasons. Rush went back to Merseyside after a single season, and the Capitano Scirea retired soon after, but was not away from the Bianconeri for long, as after Marchese left, Scirea came back as an assistant manager to new coach Dino Zoff. And in his first season, Juve was not challenging for the league title in any way, as local competition was getting fiercer between Inter led by Trapattoni, Milan led by Sacchi, and Napoli led by Maradona. As Inter managed to win the title, and despite signing the talented Portuguese Rui Baros and Nerazzurri legend Alessandro Altobelli, Juve ended the season in a disappointing fourth position, and they crashed out of the UEFA Cup against Napoli, which was a tournament that had great competition between big European clubs, which is not the case in the present time. The Bianconeri started the next season with some tragic and shocking news, as after traveling to Poland in September of 89 to scout the next opponent in the UEFA Cup, Shiria was involved in a fatal car accident which caused his demise at just 36 years of age.
Per una ragione veramente tremenda, è morto Gaetano Shiria.
And with the transfer of Capitano Cabrini and Laudrup to Barcelona, the Bianconeri had lost part of its core. But the team was reinforced with some exciting young talents from the second division, like Skillaci and Casiraghi. And despite the criticism aimed at Zoff in the beginning of the season and the departure of Boniberti as club president, who was replaced by Vittorio Cuisano, the Bianconeri was slowly becoming a real contender after winning 3-0 against title holders Milan in March. And thanks to top goal scorer Skillaci, Juve ended the season exceptionally well after winning the Coppa Italia against Milan and participating in the first all-Italian European final, as the Bianconeri won the UEFA Cup after beating Fiorentina, who had an exciting young star in their ranks named Roberto Baggio. So despite ending the season in fourth position again, Juve achieved a valuable double as they slowly returned to their natural habitat. But the decision to let Zoff leave was taken before the European final, as the ex-keeper received an offer from Lazio, as management wanted to take an entirely new approach. Management wanted to create a cultural revolution at the club, and their first step was to capture the signing of Roberto Baggio from rivals Fiorentina. The signing was the most expensive in history at that time, as Juve paid nearly 13 million euros for the Italian star. The former agent of the Italian said recently that Baggio didn't want to leave Fiorentina, but that didn't reduce the amount of anger that was witnessed in the streets of Florence after numerous protests from the Fiorentina tifosi, who were angry after the transfer and the act of treason as they saw it. And when Baggio was officially introduced after the World Cup, the photographers wanted Baggio to wear the Juve scarf, but Baggio left it on their chair in front of him. The gesture may be insignificant, but the Bianconeri tifosi didn't forget that. But on the field and after numerous seasons, finally, the old lady has replaced Michel Platini. Despite Baggio's brilliance in his first year, the Bianconeri participated in a catastrophic season. Part of the cultural revolution which management wanted to create was the decision to bring in a fairly unknown manager named Luigi Maifredi after some success at Bologna. Management searched for the new Sacchi in the managerial field, and they brought in Maifredi because he had some similar philosophies to the Rossoneri coach. But from their very first test in the Supercoppa Italiana against Napoli, there were inklings of a bad season to come for the Bianconeri, as Napoli crushed Juve by 5-1. And Maifredi struggled early in the season, as he gave more freedom to the attacking outlets he had in the team, which led to many defensive issues and headaches. And everybody waited for Baggio's return to Florence, as the Bianconeri faced Fiorentina in April in a very emotional match. And in a weird moment, Juve were handed a penalty for a chance to draw after conceding first, but Baggio refused to take it as Di Agostini missed the penalty kick. Baggio was eventually replaced before the match ended, as he received boos and whistles from each corner of the field, and a Fiorentina scarf was thrown in his direction, and surprisingly Baggio lifted the scarf and greeted the fans, a gesture which was not appreciated by the Bianconeri tifosi. Despite Baggio scoring a team-high 27 goals in all competitions, Juve ended the season in 7th position, and for the first time in 27 years, the team didn't qualify to a European competition. As a result of that, Gianni Agnelli intervened in club affairs for the first time in many years and requested that the club takes a new direction. And that direction had the goal of reuniting old friends, as the Bianconeri brought back Giovanni Trapattoni and the ex-president Boniberti as CEO to work alongside Cuisano. Ex-Juve manager Trapattoni came back after big success with the Nerazzurri and entered the market with specific demands, as he brought in the German Jürgen Kohler, who managed to defuse Van Basten and Hullet's threats in the last World Cup at that time. And he brought in Angelo Peruzzi from Roma, who managed to replace the captain Tacconi in the middle of the season, and also Antonio Conte from Lecce. The team displayed huge improvements in the season, as Baggio again was the top goalscorer of the team, but he played as a forward throughout the whole season, as it was a baffling and weird decision from Trapattoni. But despite that, the Bianconeri finished in second position, as Milan was still the force to be beaten, as new manager Fabio Capello managed to go through the season and win the league unbeaten. So because of that, Trapattoni requested some big reinforcements next summer, as Juve broke another transfer record, as they brought in Gianluca Vialli from Sampdoria for roughly 17 million euros to assist Baggio in the front lines, along with the German midfielder Andres Müller and the forward Ravanelli. But from the very first match week, it was obvious from the beginning that the Rossoneri train will not stop for any team. And now the competition extended outside Torino and Milan, as Parma was now a fierce and strong team. That's why the Bianconeri focused on the UEFA Cup, as they got to the final after beating George Weah and Paris Saint-Germain in an exciting semi-final, and won the final easily against German side Dortmund by 6-1 after two entertaining matches. The main goal for the Bianconeri was still the Scudetto, and there were signs in the summer that pointed towards that possibility after the departure of big names like Rijkaard and Hullet, and also after Van Basten was injured again at Milan. And Juve reinforced the team again and brought in a young and talented left-back named Fortunato, and a duo from Padova in Serie B, Angelo Di Livio in midfield, and a young and unknown 19-year-old named Alessandro Del Piero. And the Bianconeri started the season well in the opening months, before they were struck by the news of Vialli's injury, which sidelined the Italian forward for the whole season. But Roberto Baggio carried the team with his goals and won the prestigious Ballon d'Or in 1993. The manager Trapattoni gave little chances to the young Del Piero, especially after Vialli's absence, and he scored his first goal in only his second match against Reggiana, and then scored his first hat-trick in his young professional career in March of 1994.
Fabulous strike! It's 3 for the 19-year-old.
But following a loss against title challengers Milan in the Delle Alpi, the Rossoneri built a significant lead as Capello's men won their third league title in a row. And this time, Giovanni Trapattoni and Giampiero Boniberti left for good, after 33 years of managerial service for the Bianconeri, as a new era starts for Juventus Football Club. Ex-Bianconeri legend Roberto Bettega came in to replace Boniberti as vice president, and he brought along Luciano Moggi as general manager and Antonio Giraudo as CEO. Their first managerial decision was to bring in the Italian manager Marcelo Lippi, who had spent a single and successful season at Napoli, as the Italian manager managed to deal with Napoli's numerous financial problems after Maradona's departure in the beginning of the 90s. And pushed the team to a European position. And Bettega handed the new manager the task of ending the league drought, which the old lady has endured for 9 years. But Umberto Agnelli, the club's honorary president, was very skeptical to say the least, as he told the new manager that Ferrari's chances of winning the World Cup were higher than Juve's chances of winning the Scudetto. And with the new management, the issue of the Delle Alpi Stadium was brought up, as it was beginning to be a source of agony for both Juve and Torino since the two clubs were handed the stadium after the World Cup in 1990. Some of the issues pertaining to the Delle Alpi Stadium was the bad vision from the stands because of the Olympic tracks separating the field and the fans, which affected the atmosphere for the matches. Another critical issue was the high operating costs, as Juve's management figured out that the total operating costs paid in 5 years could finance the project of building a new and smaller stadium that operates more efficiently. But despite these high costs and expenses, the Bianconeri greatly reinforced the team with the Portuguese Paulo Sousa, the Italian Ciro Ferrara, and the Frenchman Didier Deschamps. And the new season brought with it new footballing changes from the Italian Federation, as now the winning team will be rewarded with 3 precious points instead of 2. With that in mind, Lippi sought to use a strange formation for Serie A at that time, the 4-3-3, as he wanted to make use of his 4 outstanding attacking stars. And those 4 were Roberto Baggio, Vialli, Ravanelli, and Del Piero from the bench. And there were many defensive instructions for the trident in front to cover the spaces in the middle and the wings. And despite the big disappointment in the 94 World Cup, after Baggio missed a crucial penalty kick against Brazil, the divine ponytail came back strongly to Juve and got back to his best. And after scoring a beautiful free kick against Padova in November, Baggio severely injured his knee and will miss some time on the sidelines. And in the following match against Fiorentina in the Delle Alpi, everybody saw Juve state without their number one star, as Laviola scored 2 goals in the first half. And 15 minutes before the end of the match, the Bianconeri served a historic rimonta.
Protagonismo parte, il cross! Colpo di testa di Vialli, stavolta non lascia il grappolo di uomini. Fischia furibonda, Vialli! Vialli la mette dentro!
Campo cerca di organizzare la propria manovra.
Attenzione Del Piero, incredibile gol di Del Piero.
Both Vialli and Del Piero served a masterclass, which made the fans forget Roberto Baggio a bit. And Juve continued on their positive path until snatching the league lead in January. And suddenly Baggio was in a curious position, as the Italian's contract will end at the end of the season. And Vice President Bettega was quoted in December saying that Juve has no intentions in fighting over keeping Baggio at the Bianconeri. The old lady kept their charge in the league until Baggio's return from injury in March, as the divine ponytail helped Juve to the finish line. And after 9 years, the Bianconeri managed to claim the league title against Parma, who were the challengers throughout the season, by 4-0. Juve dedicated this win to their young left-back Fortunato, who sadly passed away in the middle of the season after losing his battle with leukemia. The Bianconeri then achieved the double against Parma after winning the Coppa Italia, but failed to achieve the treble after losing against the same team in the UEFA Cup final. And with the summer break, the Baggio rumors were in full force, but Juve's management didn't wait long, as they agreed to let go of Baggio to Milan for 9 million euros, which was paid at that time before Bosman's rule as a compensation for any player that leaves after his contract ends. The fans were furious by this decision, and they were skeptical that a young 20-year-old will succeed in replacing one of the best players in the world. But management had other views and were fairly confident of this decision.
Del Piero, a goal! Gol di Del Piero! L'avversario cerca di far girare il pallone, riesce a far girare il pallone! Juve in vantaggio, incredibile!
Juve finally qualified to the Champions League after 9 long years. And Alessandro Del Piero performed exceptionally well in the group stages after scoring 5 goals. And in the league, Milan returned as a fierce competitor once again, not only because of Baggio's arrival, but after George Weah's signing, who received the prestigious Ballon d'Or in December of 95. Juve failed to win their head-to-head matches against the Rossoneri, as Milan created a gap in the lead and eventually won their fourth league title in the last 5 years. But the Bianconeri focused on the prestigious Champions League title, which left the Bianconeri's grasp since 1985. But that particular triumph is not fondly remembered, as the disaster that happened prior to that final prevented any kind of celebration of the title.
Hooliganism has struck again, and I'm afraid the scenes are as bad as anything we've seen for a long, long time.
That's why the Bianconeri wanted to win and celebrate this time with the title. And after qualifying to the second round, they faced a struggling Madrid side who were in the middle of a transitional period, as the Bianconeri managed to come back after losing the first leg thanks to a Del Piero free kick.
Del Piero, attenzione, gol! La Juventus!
Which was followed by a win against French champions Nantes and qualified to the final to face the title holders Ajax Amsterdam, led by Van Gaal, held in the Olympico Stadium in Rome. The two teams entered the final with different tactics, as Lippi continued with his 4-3-1-2, which proved successful this season, and Louis van Gaal entered with a typical Dutch 3-4-3. And after Ravanelli scored from an impossible angle, the tournament's top goalscorer Jari Litmanen managed to draw level.
Litmanen scored!
And following some chances for both teams, the penalty shootout will decide the fate of the title.
Mr. Edgar Davids, and Perazzi saves!
Attenzione alla battuta di Ferrara, tiro gol!
Bravo giro, bravo giro!
Secondo Peruzzi, parte il tiro, attenzione, gol!
Pesotto scored! Order Schulten make an error!
Prende la rincorsa, attenzione!
Ed è gol, ed è gol!
Oh, it's a fine save! Peruzzi has taken Juventus to the cusp of glory! Juventus are European champions! Celebrations they feel are overdue!
Don't change a winning team. It's a common phrase in sports, but doesn't mean a thing to Juve's management. Because if they saw a player who has reached the peak of his potential and value, he can be sold instantly. That's what happened to Paulo Sousa. And along with the Portuguese Sousa, management made a mini rebuild to the team as they let go of the captain Vialli, Ravanelli, Massimo Carrera, and the veteran Vierkovut, and brought in numerous young and exciting players like Boksic, Christian Vieri, Amoruso, Montero, and a young Frenchman from Bordeaux, Zinedine Zidane. This policy of chopping and changing didn't affect the manager Lippi, as he was a flexible tactician and had great man management skills and could deal with all kinds of characters, and also offers effective training regimes that suits any player. But one player struggled to cope in the beginning, as despite being a somewhat cheap transfer, fans were skeptical towards Zidane in the opening months, as he struggled while playing within a three-man midfield setup, as he had many defensive instructions from the manager, which made it hard for him to express himself on the field. But with Conte's injury in the middle of the season, Deschamps was the lone defensive midfielder, and Zidane was pushed to the tip of a four-man diamond and became an integral part of the team. And after deciding the game against Inter Milan in October, Juve pushed for a new title as they snatched the league lead in December. The team then departed to Tokyo to participate in the Intercontinental Cup as they won against River Plate thanks to Del Piero's winner, and also won the UEFA Super Cup after destroying Paris Saint-Germain by 9-2 after two legs. And in the group stages of the Champions League, they won home and away against United and qualified to the second round. And despite Boksic and Del Piero's absence because of injury in March, the Bianconeri was not affected, as they plugged in Bobo Vieri and Amoruso in the attack and went to the San Siro to face title holders Milan to stake their claim on the Scudetto.
Vieri controlla, sfida. dall'uno contro uno Baresi e poi sul tapin la Juventus va in vantaggio per Jugovic che la prova ed è il gol, in posizione regolare ed è il quarto gol, quinto gol e c'è il sesto gol beffato ancora una volta da Vieri.
After this historic victory, Juve faced Ajax Amsterdam again, but this time in the semi-finals. And following a win away from home by 2-1, Juve came back to the Dele Alpi as Zidane had his best match in Juve colors since he signed with the team, as he assisted 2 goals and scored the other to make sure Juve qualify to their second final in a row. And despite a late surge in the standings by Parma led by Ancelotti, Juve managed to clinch the Scudetto at Bergamo against Atalanta thanks to Uliano's goal, and went after 5 days to the Champions League final to face a familiar foe for Juve in the last few years, Borussia Dortmund, led by manager Otmar Hitzfeld. It's important to note that Dortmund's squad had numerous ex-Juve players, as after the Italians won against the Germans in the 93 UEFA Cup final, 5 players switched sides, and they were Paulo Sousa, Andres Müller, Jürgen Kohler, Reuter, and the Brazilian Julio Cesar, who missed the final due to injury. But Juve entered as clear favorites, despite Del Piero only starting on the bench after coming back from an injury. But Dortmund wanted to write their history in Munich.
Il cross lungo, Jukovic va giù!
Rigore!
Attenzione!
Era rigore!
Il tiro! E rete! Attenzione! Saltano tutti, attenzione a Ridle, Ridle! Ed è rete! Ridle! E gol! Borussia in vantaggio al 28esimo! Difensori, il colpo di testa e c'è il gol! Ancora lui! Ridle, incredibile! 2-0 per il Borussia! Zidane, zona tiro, destro, palo!
No,
incredibile!
Fortunato.
Resiste, mette in mezzo, Del Piero, tocco!
Rete,
e c'è il gol! Gol fantastico di Del Piero!
Gauche a Pisa. Place à Erlich, Ricken, justement, Lars Ricken, c'est son premier ballon, le coup de génie, comme dans un rêve, quelle entrée foudroyante de la part de Lars Ricken.
Incredibile, Ricken, appena entrato, 3-1 per il Borussia, fischio finale, Borussia di Dortmund è campione d'Europa.
A loss in a Champions League final was not a new concept for Juve, as they lost twice before that, but Moggi saw a chance for change, as he got rid of Jugovic, Boksic and Vieri, who had a spat with Lippi in the end of the previous season. And in came the best young player in the league and top goal scorer last season, Elpi Ponzaghi, at 23 years of age, to form a dangerous duet with Del Piero. And with Zidane in the playmaker role, Juve now has a trident like no other in the league. But Inter's president Massimo Moratti bought himself a present and signed Ronaldo for a record fee to join a team which was somewhat a challenger last season. And from the very first week, the competition was fierce between the Bianconeri and the Nerazzurri for the Scudetto. And despite losing in the Giuseppe Meazza against Inter, Juve were winter champions thanks to the goals of the dangerous duo of Inzaghi and Del Piero. But with Deschamps' injury in the end of November, Juve brought in the Dutch Edgar Davids in the January transfer window from Milan, after he was labelled a rotten apple by the Rossoneri players, but managed to slot in well in the middle at Juve and gave them the energy they needed. This time the old lady struggled in the group stages of the Champions League, in a group that contained Manchester United once again. However, they managed to qualify to the second round as the best runners-up between all the groups, and only by goal difference. However, in the knockout stages, the Bianconeri were a different animal, and it was not crazy to say that Del Piero was the best player in the world at that time. The Bianconeri got to another final, their third in a row. But before playing that match, the Bianconeri had to face the Nerazzurri in the Dele Alpi, who were 1 point away in the Scudetto standings. The story is now very well known. Del Piero scored first, and Inter missed a couple of chances. And after a couple of hard tackles, in came the controversial play, after the ref didn't call a penalty for Inter after a clear obstruction on Ronaldo. The referee Cicerini told recently that he should have called for an indirect free kick in the box for Inter. But the play didn't stop there, as after the counter, Juve were given a penalty on the other side in front of the furious Inter players and bench. Del Piero missed the penalty kick, but the Nerazzurri failed to draw level and lost the match. And then Juve clinched the Scudetto after 2 weeks against Bologna, thanks to Inzaghi's hat-trick. And went on to face Real Madrid in the Champions League final, as El Merengue wanted to lift the cup that left their grasp since 1966. The duo that Juve were dependent on throughout the season failed to make a stamp on the match, as Juve lost that physical aspect in the attack which came in the past from the likes of Boksic and Vieri. And then came the controversial play. This time the Bianconeri was the victim, after Mijatovic scored from what seemed to be an offside position. But Mijatovic was adamant that all the replays didn't show the position of the left back Pisotto, who could have played the Montenegrin and the rest onside. But away from all the controversies, the reality was that El Merengue was up by a goal, and Juve came back with a couple of dangerous chances, but in came the ref's whistle to confirm a new loss for Juve in a Champions League final, and their fourth in history. Moggi and management were not active in the market and didn't change the team a lot, as they believed that the group was still strong and a favorite for any competition. But it was rumored that Lippi, whose contract will end at the end of the season, wanted to leave that summer, as Moggi didn't fulfill his requests of buying 5 additional players. But Moggi asked Lippi to respect the contract and stay for the last year. Lippi believed that this group had lost some motivation, especially after competing on all fronts for consecutive years. And in the first test of the season in the Supercoppa against Lazio, there were signs of that, after losing by 2-1. But despite that, the Bianconeri managed to sit on top of the Scudetto in November, before entering a match that will change Juve's fortunes for the seasons to come. The 8th of November 1998, Juve went to face Udinese. The result was 2-1 for the Bianconeri, and in the dying minutes, Del Piero wanted to catch a ball that was really going nowhere. And then what everybody feared actually happened.
Il capitano della Juventus colpisce Del Piero.
Immediately after Del Piero's exit, the alarm bell started to go off, as Sosa scored the equalizer in the last minute. The newspapers and reports confirmed that Del Piero, the young 23-year-old star, had ruptured the anterior and posterior ligaments in his left knee, and will have to go to the United States to do the necessary surgery, and will stay out of Juve's plans until next summer, as Alex will not return the same player. And with Del Piero's absence, Juve struggled deeply, as they failed to win in 6 consecutive matches in the league and failed to score a goal in 511 minutes, which all but ended their bid for the Scudetto. But there were some positive news, as Juve barely qualified to the knockout stages in the Champions League, and Zidane lifted the prestigious Ballon d'Or mainly for his efforts in the 98 World Cup. But other than that, it was a weak season, as the rift between Lippi and upper management started to escalate, as the newspapers wrote that the Italian manager accepted the offer to manage Inter next season. And then came another spat in February, when Deschamps admitted that he had a violent fight in the locker rooms with his Italian manager. So after the loss against Parma in the same month, Lippi resigned, as he closes a big and successful chapter with the Bianconeri. And then came Carlo Ancelotti, the exciting young manager from Parma, who was not well received by the Bianconeri fans, as the Tifosi lifted banners stating that the pig cannot coach, which poked fun at the ex-Rossoneri's farmer background. And before Ancelotti's arrival, Juve tried to replace Del Piero in the winter mercato and brought in a promising 21-year-old Frenchman from Monaco named Thierry Henry. There were many reasons that made this a failed transfer, but in short, Ancelotti was not aware of Henry's potential at center forward and mostly played as a left midfielder in a 4-4-1-1 system and had numerous defensive duties as well. And Ancelotti admitted recently that he regrets that tactical decision a lot. And Henry said recently that he had lost the passion to play football at that time, as Moggi wanted to include him within the transfer of Udinese striker Amoroso, as Henry leaves on loan to the Friulian side. But Henry refused to transfer, and eventually Juve accepted an offer from Arsenal in the summer. The Bianconeri managed to get to the semi-finals of the Champions League and displayed good performances despite the circumstances, and after Inzaghi scored twice in the return leg against United,
Inzaghi had struck for Juventus.
Juve were close to a fourth final in a row, but United quickly managed to come back and beat the Italians. The Bianconeri ended the catastrophic season in 8th position, as Piruzzi, Di Livio and Deschamps all left, as the team closed a successful decade. But it was the beginning of new complications for the Bianconeri entering the new decade, as after the quotes and accusations of Roma coach Zdenek Zeman in the summer of 1998, the roots of suspicion were planted in the old lady's garden, as the Czech coach accused Juve of using performance-enhancing drugs in recent years. And through the following years and after big successes, Juve were still under the microscope since Zeman's quotes, until the big scandal was revealed.
Juventus Football Club.
Luciano Moggi.
Delle intercettazioni telefoniche.
Scandali del calcio italiano.
I conti con la Juve in B.
La Serie B.
And similar to the Totonero scandal in the 80s, Italian football was changed forever.